fifth in our Mauna Kea speaker series. We're still trying to figure out how often to do these, especially in the summer. So thank you, Nathan, for doing this today. But I think for those of you that don't know, Nathan Stevenson came here to get his master's degree in the TCBS program, the Tropical Conservation Biology Environmental Studies program, with Dr. Ryan Peroy, who's sitting here as his advisor working on an erosion project that Office of Mauna Kea Management had sponsored. And Ryan, brought along Nathan as a graduate student, or Nathan came along getting into his background. Okay, I'll skip on that. I'll skip some of that. But anyway, Nathan ended up working on modeling arthropod habitat on Mauna Kea using much of the erosion data, which I'm not going to go into so that I don't spill the beans on Nathan's talk. Hear about his work, both his master's thesis, and he published an article in the Journal of Insect Conservation earlier this year. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Nathan, and hopefully all the audio works.
All right, sounds like I think it's working. Thank you, Fritz. I'm a recent TCBS graduate. I graduated just over a year ago now. I've been working full-time for the university under Ryan in the Spatial Data Lab, working on a number of different projects. But I've kind of always started on working on the mountain in my master's thesis and kind of continued on some other projects. We're good with the volume, please. So this is a picture I'm just going to leave up for a second. This is standing on the summit proper, the true summit, and looking down towards Hilo. And this picture gives a whole lot of information about what the summit is really like. It's kind of this alien environment to us. It's very different. It's considered an Aeolian desert. It's high above the cloud layer in this picture. And it highlights a number of different topographic features. It's kind of this gray, sandish looking, very flat, very dense, glaciated region. And then you see this complex of cinder cones kind of protruding out. It shows just the variability up there. And going into this project, we knew that there's a whole lot of variability in the topography, and in the mineralogy, and in the environment itself up there. And that's something that, if you're trying to model habitat, you need to categorize the environment in a way that you kind of understand it enough to apply it towards the species. So that was kind of a daunting task, and this is probably my favorite view of the summit, looking down towards Hilo. Although I get the pleasure of standing up here and giving this presentation, it obviously wasn't a one-man show. As Fritz said, I had a graduate committee. Dr. Ryan Foy was my main advisor and the spatial person in this project. And then Dr. Jesse Ivan, who I like to say is the world leading biggie bug expert, who this talk is mainly focused around. And then Frederick Foster, who's the OMKM contact, who kind of had the big ideas going into this and generated a lot of the research questions and the funding and provided personnel and vehicles to go up and down the mountain. And obviously a bunch of other people that have helped with field collection, processing of the data, and overall support. And also UNAFCO, which is a land surveying company that we've hired out twice now to do some LIDAR data acquisition. And this is just another picture. So this is looking at the summit. The last picture was looking from the summit down towards Hilo. This is looking at the summit now. And I like this picture too because it highlights the topographic changes. You can see that there's snow on one side, and there's not snow on another side. And these small topographic shifts really have a big dramatic impact in the environment, or it can, as you can see here, with snow persisting on the northern slopes and not on the southern slopes. And this is kind of something that we see quite often. You can see the trail going up to the summit. And you can start to see a little bit of the different changes in the rock types here, with some red and some darker colored rocks and some sand colored looking rocks here. Again, just highlighting the topographic change in the environment. The environment can shift kind of dramatically in a short space. So I met Ryan back in undergrad, where we started doing some research together, and where a lot of these themes like remote sensing and data collection and field work was really introduced to me as an undergrad. So our first project together was here in Isle Royale National Park. To the north here, we have Canada, so it's right off the coast of Canada. It's a beautiful island archipelago. where they're doing a large predator prey study. It's the longest running large predator prey study on Earth still. And as you can see here, the wolf populations, this is basically just an oscillation of wolves and moose. So the wolf population is high, the moose population is low, vice versa. Lately, the wolf population has come into decline. They're talking about bringing some more wolves over. And this is on the main island, the largest island that they're doing this study. But I actually did my work here with Dr. Croy and a number of other people. This is called Passage Island, which is a small, uninhabited island off the coast of Canada, with the only structures being this lighthouse here and a number of associated structures as well. But it's completely uninhabited. And we lived here for a couple of days collecting some LIDAR data and also doing some soil sampling, looking at heavy metals concentrations. So this is a very interesting project, and this is just a rendition of what LIDAR data can look like, and I'll jump into it a little bit later too and have a video. It's a little bit easier to understand when you have a video. So again, as an undergrad, this was just kind of all introduced to me. And then I decided to further my education, coming here to Hawaii, a different island archipelago, and working here on the summit, doing a lot of the same things, you know, data collection, field work, LIDAR, remote sensing, and applying it to something completely new to me. That would be this arthropod species. I've never worked with bugs in the past. I don't so much even really like bugs, but this project had a lot of the themes that I really did enjoy, remote sensing and data collection. So here we have the summit of Mauna Kea on the Big Island. Here's a satellite view. This is World View 2 satellite imagery. This is another interesting perspective of the summit, showing these different clusters of cinder cones or cinder cone complexes. And then in between them, this very, very different and glaciated region. You can see the glacial striations and these remnant glacial features that's very different from the cinder cones that's between them.
Can you explain glacial striation?
So these just kind of striations here that you see. Usually from the glacier moving steadily downhill, and they leave these kind of moraines and these kind of dugout features. So that's what I meant by that. But basically, just the very stark differences between you have these glaciated features and then these non-glaciated cinder cones. So that's kind of the overarching theme here. Going into this study, and I'll talk about the baby bug in a second, but we've known from years and years of research from graduates and postdocs and people like Jesse and his predecessor and other people in the Bishop Museum that have been collecting information about this bug for years now, that their habitat is something like 11,000 feet and up. That's kind of where we've narrowed the range. So for that reason, we decided to take everything from 10,000 up. That would be our study site, so that we make sure we capture the entire known range and more if needed for this bug. So this is kind of what we've limited our study area to. And just some background about the mountain. It's very, very high up. It's just under 14,000 feet or just over 4,200 meters. So it's a very different environment than down here. It's something like 25 to 30% less air pressure, which these bugs have kind of adapted to. There's also kind of devoid of major plant life. So many bugs either live on plants or cocoon on plants, eat plants. Up here it's very different. I'll talk about that in a second too. So I've been mentioning these glacial features. Over the course of history, there's been something like 3 to 4 glaciation episodes. This is figured out through different remnant marks that I was mentioning myself. And then also, as we all probably know, it's a very culturally significant region for many reasons. And then interestingly enough, in terms of habitat, looking at it from a habitat perspective, there's all these different observatories and buildings and parking lots and roads, but we're not totally sure how that affects habitat or if it does affect habitat. So going into this project, that was another thing just to keep in mind that we've always had to think about. So here's some archaeological site visits that I went on. This is going back to cultural significance. This is an ad site that we visited with the archaeological crew. Here's another one. This is called Uprights. These are some nice archaeological features. Makanaka, the very first cinder cone that I showed, the very first picture, We also hiked to there, which is a few hours of hike. It was very nice. And then we have also these kind of hidden things that if you're just walking around or you're just hiking up there, you might not see. So this is a caterpillar. We have moths. We have, you know, Lycosa spiders. There's a whole world of these bugs that unless you're looking in the right places or unless you know how to attract them, you almost never see. You know, they're invisible to most people. But surprisingly enough, there's, you know, a multitude of these different species up there that we're still collecting more and more information on. So the bug of the hour, the Vicky bug here, and I'll pass this around. They've been in this vial for, I think, about a year now, so they're starting to lose their little legs. But these are adults. You can pass it around. They're about 5 millimeters when they reach their adult stage. They're very, very small, almost totally invisible unless you're looking at that great place. So that was another challenge going into this project. You know, we're trying to find something that's millimeters and then describe its habitat, which is this huge, vast summit. So it was first discovered in 1979 and then published about 1980. And it's actually Nicias is a seed bug family. But interestingly enough, it doesn't eat seeds whatsoever. Unlike many of the other family members, it's a carnivorous scavenger. So it feeds on both dead and dying insects. It eats their blood and their guts. And basically it scavenges on insects that have been blown up to the summits. So that's what this aeolian food source is. Their only food source are lower elevation arthropods that get caught in the wind columns and blown up to the summit because they're not adapted to the harsh conditions, you know, the small lack of oxygen and also the variability in climate up there from day to day. They die or they fall susceptible to these bugs, and then they kind of scavenge around and eat them, which is interesting. And doesn't go with its family name whatsoever, which again means seed bug. And they're endemic only to the summit. As I said before, they also have a sister species called Nicias aa, which is endemic to the Mauna Loa summit. It fills a very similar ecological niche. And I have here delisted in 2011. They're never actually on the endangered species list. They're a candidate for listing under the Endangered Species Act, but then were removed as a candidate in 2011. And although we collect information about a lot of bugs, this is the target for many people. It's the most studied bug on this summit. And since I am more focused on data acquisition and environmental and topographic data, and not so much the biology or physiology, I'll just kind of briefly detail this. They're flightless, which is important to know. They kind of just crawl around the cinders all day long. That's what they live in. They don't fly from cinder cone to cinder cone or anything like that. They're diurnally active. They're most active during the day when it's nice and warm. When it's very cold and there's ice present, they move really slowly. They're lethargic, but they are cold tolerant. They do survive. And then they have this ingenious thermoregulation technique. On the summit, there's a layer of very, very fine ash, and then on top of it, a layer of cinder. Sometimes this layer is thick, sometimes it's not. But they use this layer, they crawl up and down the cinder layer to kind of escape this thermal variability from day to day and night to night. So that's how they survive in this when it is cold. So as I was mentioning before, going into this, there's all these people that have looked into this bug before, and they've kind of already described its habitat. Here's a number of different things: north and east slopes, nunataks, porous scoria, ash to 10 centimeter cinder size, tougher ridges, and all these things kind of have one thing in common. They're describing a cinder cone, and they're not so much describing the outlining surrounding glacial regions. They're all kind of detailing the cinder cone. So going into this is something that we've already known, but we didn't know if each cinder cone is created equal. Is one cinder cone better than the other in terms of habitat, or is there microhabitat regions within a single cinder cone? So that is something that we are trying to understand a little bit further at this time. So this is a great map created by Jessica Kirkpatrick here and Dr. Jesse Ivan. This is back in 2012. And as I was saying, we're trying to figure out if all cinder cones are created equal or if some are better than the other. But back in 2012, just a few years ago, before we knew some of these things, if one or more bug was caught on a cinder cone, the whole cinder cone is considered bug habitat. When I say bug, I'm just referring to the baking bug alone. So you can see these green blobs here. These are cinder cones and cinder cone tails that one or more baking bug was caught on. This is kind of the extent or the limit of kind of prioritizing cinder cones. We just say that they're all habitat if they had a successful capture. So when we're talking about captures, there's all these different capture locales that the Office of Monarchy and Management goes to every single summer. So they have an annual trapping protocol where they go out, they let these traps sit for about 2 to 3 days in the summer and go back and you collect the bugs. And you can see here, there's all different sorts of captures. The size and the color of the dots here represent the number of bugs caught in that location. You can see, it's not the same, it's not uniform. Sometimes there's bugs caught, sometimes there's a lot of bugs caught. Sometimes, you know, maybe on the right side there's more, on the left side of the slope there's less. So every cinder cone maybe isn't created equal. Maybe there are these microhabitat regions. Maybe each cinder cone doesn't pose a homogeneous habitat, but instead has certain habitats that are better or maybe more suited for these bugs. So basically going into it, we wanted to know why we catch these bugs, where we catch them, what environmental influences are causing us to catch these bugs where we have in the past. And then can we use those environmental variables to model where their habitat would be across the entire summer? That's what our research questions for this specific objective were. So in order to model a bug's habitat, you need to have a number of different things. Number one, you need to have successfully caught it and or taken a GPS location where it was sighted, preferably many times. Some very, very rare species, if you only have a couple positive occurrences, it's very difficult to model their habitat. But if you have many occurrences in different regions, then you can model their habitat and then have, you know, maybe give a robust model that accurately shows their habitat. So starting off, what is maximum entropy habitat modeling? This is the program that I use, it's an industry standard. Basically, it takes your environmental variables, whatever kind of environmental variables you have, maybe it's something about topography or climate, and you can kind of stack them all on top of one another. You input your species occurrence data, and then it can output something like this. This is just a standard output. This is for, I believe this is for poison dart frogs in South America, with red being higher or more suitable habitat, yellow being marginal, green being uninhabitable. So this is, if you put in the right environmental data layers and enough species occurrence, then you can get something like this. But we're not working on a continental scale. We're working on basically this just very, very small, you know, tens of thousands of acres or less on the summit. So I wanted to first find out, can we apply this to something that's a much smaller scale? So I found this very interesting study. You can see by the scale bar here, 1 kilometer. So this isn't a very big region, and this is for bats. So you could actually use this maximum entropy modeling technique at this very small scale as well, which is good for us. So number one, first and foremost, you need to know where the bugs are or have caught them in the past. So we have this very, very detailed, lengthy record of not just baking bugs, but many, many other bugs that have been caught on the summit. So there's actually been more than 1,071 locations to date. Every single year, more and more traps are placed. We've had 410 positive hits or positive successful detections of the baking bug. 410, at least one or more. It could be more, but 410 locations of successfully capturing this bug. So this is kind of what a trap would look like. It's very rudimentary, simple, but easy. It's two Dixie cups. You poke a hole in one Dixie cup, you take some paper towel, you wad it up, put it through the hole, and it acts as a wick. Then you put some water in the second Dixie cup, slide them together. That gives the bugs enough water that they survive, but not too much that they drown. Throw a couple rocks in there, and then their favorite part, since they're scavengers, you put in some nice smelly tuna. And then they're attracted to that. Since they're scavengers, they're attracted to the smell. They'll come, they'll crawl around in the cinders, and then they jump in this cup. They're nice, they're happy, they're fed, they're hydrated. And then a couple days later, we come by and count what's in it. and then it's a live release. So that's an important part. It's a live trap, live release. So this is just a picture of a couple of people putting a trap in, probably talking about whether it should be flush with the cinder layer or flush with the ash layer. It's something of a contention. So this is kind of what it's like. You'll hike around the mountain, you put these traps all over, mainly in the summer. Jess is now looking at seasonable variability going out every few months, which might change a few things. So we go out, we lay a number of traps, a couple days later, you see what's in them. Simple design, very effective. So now that we've had years and years of this trap capture data, we need to characterize the environment in a way that we can use it for these habitat models. So number one, in order to characterize the terrain, LIDAR or terrestrial laser scanning is a way to collect very, very dense, very high resolution topographic information. And once you do this, you can derive a bunch of different products or a bunch of different habitat variables. So we employed terrestrial laser scanning in 2014. We've since repeated it in 2017, which will be used for some change detection. I'll touch on that again if we have a little bit of time. But basically, we collected centimeter scale point data across roughly 15 kilometers, which was a huge undertaking, about 10 days, a lot of support staff. And here is just a video of what LIDAR data looks like. It's a very, very dense assemblage of points. So this is a 3D representation of the topography on the summit. Very accurate, very dense. And this was kind of our first environmental layers that we were collecting. And from this, you can get a whole number of derivatives that I'll touch on right after this. But we basically set up a scan location. This is what a typical setup would look like. It's just a machine on a tripod, and it scans at 360 degrees. We did this at 94 different locations. You can kind of see our spatial distribution across the summit. And I probably won't touch on too much, but basically there's a number of different things you do to make sure that the data acquisition is accurate and your end product is good. And going into that, something using these special targets to tie scan to scan. So this was kind of our LIDAR coverage. You can see there's these couple very strange occlusions or shadows. And this is where no data points were present. And this is because the circular one on the left here is because of a cinder cone that's very, very tall, Pu'uhaukea, and it's a convex crater. And unless you actually hiked this very expensive and very heavy equipment into the crater, it's impossible for the sensor to see in there. This one on the right, this odd-shaped one, is the backside of a very, very steep, almost 45-degree angle cinder cone that we then didn't feel comfortable hiking very heavy equipment down into. So we had these holes in the data, but we knew from past trapping and some trapping that we did in 2016 that there are bugs in each of these holes. So they're important regions, and we just couldn't ignore them. We just couldn't accept this no data. So again, this is kind of what LIDAR looks like. This is that same hole, the same no data hole of Pu'uhaukea. But fortunately for us, there's this awesome new technique called structure from motion, which you can take regular two-dimensional pictures, very similar to your cell phone. We used a high-resolution Nikon camera. And you can take them in such a way that there's enough overlap between every single picture, kind of like this. Every green dot is where I took a picture. I moved a little bit, took another picture, moved a little bit, took another picture, and I surrounded the cinder cone crater looking into it doing this. And through structure from motion, you can produce something that's very similar to a LIDAR point cloud. And this is what it looks like now. So we filled in the data using this photogrammetry technique to supplement where we didn't have LIDAR data. We did a very similar thing in a different region. This was using a handheld camera. This is in the Natural Area Reserve. This is in the Natural Area Reserve, which unfortunately, I think for them, does not have a drone policy right now. It's a total ban on drones. So we used a handheld camera and did the old-fashioned hiking instead of drones. But we did use This is our Inspire one. We flew over the other cinder cone area that we didn't have data for, which doesn't have a no drone policy. So that was nice to employ that we didn't have to hike. It was very, very steep. It's almost 45 degrees, the cinder cone. So in doing this, we filled in these two different data gaps that we knew were important to have done. And here's a great picture, safety first, wearing our safety vests on the summit, flying around. There's Ryan in his glasses, making sure nothing bad happens on the computer. We have an entourage taking pictures. It's very cohesive. Data collection is great. So I was talking about a number of different derivatives that you can create once you have LiDAR data or this point data. One is a digital elevation model. So every pixel has an elevation associated with it. And this is a combination of both our TLS or terrestrial laser scanning and structure for motion data. You can also derive aspect in degrees. You can also derive slope. And slope, I think, is really interesting because you can see the cinder cones, you can see the cinder cone breaks, and where that difference lies, not necessarily in mineralogy, but in slope. You can see where the cinder cones are off here on the right. But working through these models, we figured out that aspect from a 1 to 360 degree kind of circular data doesn't really work for models. For example, 359 degrees and 1 or 2 degrees is pretty much north. It's pretty much the same thing, but it's a very different number. So we transformed aspect into something called northness and eastness, which is a number from -1 to 1. It's better suited for modeling. It's much easier for the modeling programs to deal with that.
So what does aspect mean?
Aspects of 0 to 360 degrees is basically north, east, south, west. From 0 to 360 degrees. So 0 would be north.
Yes, the direction the landscape is facing.
Yeah. So, I guess I could have explained that better. If you look right here, for example, this is Haukea. Since it's this large circular cinder cone, part of the cinder cone faces one way, part of it faces another way. And that's something that we thought might be important. If you recall back to the second picture I showed of the summit with snow on one side and not on the other. So aspect may be important. We're going to let the model tell us if it was important because snow can persist on different aspects more so than other aspects. And there's a whole number of other things with like solar irradiance and how different aspects heat up during the day. So different thermal properties also, because if it's not facing the sun rays in the shadow, it can be a lot different temperature than something that's aspect of the slope that's directly in the sun. Is that better?
Yeah.
All right, so we used that to characterize the terrain, but there's also these different features. You can see different colors. Different cinder cones are different colors, and the glaciated region is certainly a different color. So we thought maybe there's differences in land cover classes. We wanted to figure out what land cover classes were on the summit. Fortunately for me, a lot of people have done this already. So Wolf, back in 1996, created this map. This is mineralogy of the entire Big Island. But unfortunately, since it was the whole Big Island, it had a very coarse resolution. We're just looking at this very small area right here on the summit, and it just didn't show us enough. And then Guinness et al. And some other people collected something called Avarice data. So this is Avarice data. And this is basically just showing different minerals. The different colors are different minerals on the summit. And we didn't know if these were important. If they weren't important, we're gonna let the model kind of sort that out. But we wanted to have that data available to us. So this stuff was great, but as you can see, it doesn't cover the whole summit. So then I found this guy, Greg Schwazy, who created something like this. And you can see the cinder cones are circled in black. This is right from Greg Schwazy. I remember reading his paper as I'm doing some research for my background about the summit, and I read this paper and I thought to myself, wow, this would be perfect if I had this. So I contacted Greg Schwazy, I emailed him, we went back and forth, and he just gave it to me. He sent it over in an email and said, here it is, here's the data you need right from my paper, and it was great. But when I got it, it was 20 by 20 meters. So every single pixel was 20 meters by 20 meters, which back in 2002 when this was created, was probably pretty good, but now, as we're approaching 2017, Back when I was doing this 2015 and 2016, we now have sub-meter satellites. So we can get a much better resolution than 20 by 20. But it was still amazing to say the least. And you can see this red cinder cone here, this red cinder cone here. You can almost pick out cinder cones just based on their colors. And then the glaciated region in between them is totally different, which is something that we can see with our eyes. But when you display it like this, it's very interesting to know that the cinder cones have different mineralogies, different superficial mineralogies than the surrounding landscape. I thought that was fascinating. But to get over this 20 meter by 20 meter pixel size, we can use something called a supervised classification, which is basically training the computer using ROIs or regions of interest, train the computer using this data, and then giving it sub-meter satellite data to train with, or to train on, I should say, and then creating something like this. So this is the exact same map. Basically, it's using the same data, but now it's in a half a meter by a half a meter pixel size. So we went from this 20 meter by 20 meter, we trained the computer to see the different minerals, and then transformed it into a half a meter by a half a meter mineralogical map. So you can see there's six main minerals on the summit. And I'll point them out again. Here's a cinder cone, here's a cinder cone, here's a cinder cone complex. You can see cinder cones are kind of almost wholly composed of hematite and glassy volcanic rock, which is red and purple. And then everything else, all the glaciated region and some weird stuff in Waiau, but mainly the glaciated region is composed of all these different minerals, and the summits and the cinder cones are composed of hematite and glassy volcanic rock. So this is another distinction between these cinder cones and the surrounding environment. So here's a picture of one of the summit cinder cone craters. This is what it looks like in the 20 meter by 20 meter data. This is what it looks like in the new half a meter by half a meter. And here's the satellite data we used to train it. You can see, flip back and forth, 20 meter by 20 meter, a half meter by half a meter, and this is the satellite data. So I think we're representing the habitat and the environmental variability in terms of mineralogy much better than 20 meter by 20 meter with this new satellite data. All right, so now we have surface mineralogy. We have these derivatives from LIDAR, and then we wanted to kind of explore climate to see if climate affected these bugs' habitat. You know, normally climate has a pretty big dramatic impact on where things can live or where they can't live. So we wanted to see if that was something that was also affecting these bugs. Maybe climate was different, and that's what why we were catching them in one region and not in another. So we have this great resource here in Hawaii called the Rainfall Atlas, or the Evapotranspiration Atlas, where you can download climate for the entire island. It's in 250 meter resolution, and it's totally free. You can just download it anywhere you want. So we downloaded all these different, these are just raster representations of climate. So we downloaded these different climate layers and then ran some statistics on them. We did band collection statistics, and it turned out that many of these climate layers, five of six actually, had too high of a correlation. They were too correlated with one another. For example, this is just made up, but maybe solar radiation and surface temperature, that actually makes perfect sense. But solar radiation and surface temperature, more solar radiation, higher surface temperature, they're correlated. Unfortunately, if you have these correlated variables, it wreaks havoc on your model, because you don't know if it was temperature or if it was solar radiation that's really driving these bug captures in our case. So when you have these correlations between your habitat variables, you just simply have to remove them. You can't use them in the model. So I did run in with climate, and I'll show it later anyways, but our final models that we used did exclude climate totally. So now we can get into the final maximum entropy modeling, which produces the habitat models. That's basically a statistical interface. You load in your different environmental variables that we just went over, and then you give it your species occurrence data. And it runs these different statistical analyses on it, and it's kind of a black box. You put these things in, and it gives you this great suitability map out, but you don't necessarily know how it was made. Bug MaxEnt, again, is an industry standard, the USGS, and a lot of other people use MaxEnt to model habitat, so it's credible, but it is like a black box. You don't have a whole lot to say about how it's processed. So this is just an interesting parameter that I always show. You can see something here called random test percentage, and this is really important. It's kind of in the modeling world, at least in MaxEnt, you always withhold at least 25% of your data to then verify later on if the model produced is accurate. So it's a test percentage. So we went along with 25%, which is in the literature. And it produces something like this. So this is straight out of MaxEnt. You can see that red is higher habitat suitability or more suitable. And getting down towards blue, you're getting towards marginal and then into uninhabited. So the model kind of tells us that cinder cones, and if you can see them by now, here's a cinder cone, here's Hapea, here's a cinder cone complex, that cinder cones are the habitat for these bugs. And the glaciated regions really aren't. And we kind of already knew this. But this is also showing that all cinder cones aren't created equal. You can see that the summit complex is more suitable than Hapea, which is a little bit to the south, which is more suitable than the lower VLBAs. So each cinder cone really isn't created equal, at least according to these models. And then another interesting thing to look at is it's not a homogeneous cinder cone. They do represent microhabitat regions. And some cinder cones, Hapea, for example, showing the left side of Hapea is a little bit more suitable than the right hand side of Hapea. So this is very interesting knowledge that can then be used to kind of think about, you know, sampling strategies. If we go back, if we want to sample in you know, regions of high suitability or low suitability to verify these models. Then it also gives you something like this. It tells you why. It tells you which pieces of information are explaining the variable the most. So if you look in blue, blue is width only variable. So it runs the model with just one variable and sees how close it is to the final model of all variables. And you can see elevation is almost explaining most of the model. But there's other things too, like easterliness or eastness, hematite, and that mineralogy. You can see there's different inputs for mineralogy. And then slope is saying doesn't really matter too much. But easterliness and elevation, at least in this 1 meter model, are important. And then we also ran the model at 10 meters. So this is something I guess I didn't explain very well. When we collected the LIDAR data, we only could collect it over, even though it was about 15 square kilometers, it wasn't the whole summit. That would have taken forever and cost a lot of money. But there's this free 10 meter data that you can derive the exact same data products from, but at a 1 meter or a 10 meter. So we ran it at one. Here's our 1 meter model. That's how, why it has this kind of jagged, irregular shape. That's where our LIDAR data was. And then we could run it at this 10 meter model from freely available stuff. You can see this jagged shape where the 1 meter model was. So this is 10 meters. This is everything above 10,000 feet where the bug might live. And this is showing a very similar story that cinder cones are the preferred habitat of these bugs, of these endemic baky bugs. Saying that topography, like elevation, is really important again. And then hematite kind of bumps up in this 10 meter model. So it's saying that superficial mineralogy and elevation combined are kind of explaining why we find these bugs where we find them. And then as I was saying, I ran climate, even though we had this correlation, so it was excluded in the final analysis. I think it's interesting to see that when you have climate in the model, all six of these correlated layers are five of six, and no climate, telling almost the same story, right? It's showing that suitable habitat is in relatively the exact same regions with and without climate, which says to me that climate isn't really what's driving where we find these bugs, at least at the resolution that we currently have climate, which is in 250 meter pixels, which is why this one kind of looks a little blocky. It's because the pixels are in 250 meters and this is 10 meters. So until new climate data becomes available with a higher resolution, we're kind of putting it on the background for now. But as that becomes available, we'll incorporate it into the models. So this is the 10-meter model that I was just showing, and this is a little bit different model, but they're both showing something very similar. And they both can be used for different types of management questions that need to be answered. So on the left here, we're categorizing habitat, right? So blue would be uninhabitable, up to red, the most suitable, but we're categorizing it. So it's saying not all habitat is created equal. Some is better than other habitat regions. Whereas on this side here, it's a little bit different. Here, this is something called a 10th percentile training presence logistics statistic, which is a kind of convoluted statistic, but basically what it means is there's a threshold that you've set. And this 10th percentile training threshold is in the literature as well. And it's basically saying keep the top 90% of your data, and anything within that top 90% above that threshold is considered habitat. So instead of categorizing habitat as good, not so good, really bad, it's just saying if it's above this threshold, it's considered habitat. If it's below this threshold, it's not. And this would more be used in calculating something like total acres of habitat, which is equally as important. And this would maybe be used to prioritize areas of core habitats. You can say like, hey, this region, if we have maybe a certain amount of money or a certain amount of personnel, and we have to conserve a certain region, okay, maybe we prioritize the best. But then this would be used to talk about the entire geographic range of species. So they're both very different, both very important. So coming full circle, going back to what we knew back in 2012, 2013, where we kind of assumed that an entire cinder cone was homogeneous habitat, we kind of know now that the story stays the same, that cinder cones are the preferred habitat, but some cinder cones are better than other cinder cones. And certainly the cinder cone complex, the very summit cinder cone complex, represents the best habitat for these bugs, and it's probably because of the higher elevation, which the models have pulled out. So, also happy to announce that myself and my committee members published this just recently. So that's great. This is free. This isn't. I don't believe it's really available, but it's on the Journal of Insect Conservation. So that's a great end to that story. But one other very important aspect going into this is building up all these habitat layers and building this database of bug captures isn't meant for just a single bug. You know, these traps that are placed out, not just baking bugs go in them, all sorts of bugs go in them. You know, we find moths, maggots, red mites, you know, big scary spiders, caterpillars, all sorts of stuff we find in these traps. So we have these years of capture data and we've applied them to only this baking bug. But we have all of this data that we can now run through this framework or this working model that we've created for one bug that can now be used for any bug. So that's what this is showing. Here's a Lycosa spider and a Grotus caterpillar, which both have much higher, or I should say more habitat availability because they're more generalist species, and caterpillars can burrow into the ash substrate and whatnot. But basically, we can now run this as long as you have species occurrence data separated by species can run this framework model for anything that we catch up there, which is very interesting and can be used in competition studies or biodiversity, things like that. So that's very interesting. And then I was talking about different thermal properties. We asked that question about aspect. So here's a thermal picture. This is in the middle of the day. It's a little washed out. Everything's pretty warm, but this is a thermal picture taken from the UAV, and it's showing the observatory here, which cools their mirrors, so this is just an interesting picture. But we've actually created thermal mosaics, which is putting a bunch of different pictures together. So here is the summit cinder cone crater in thermal. So this is just temperatures. And it's showing that different slopes really do have drastically different temperature properties and thermal properties, at least dependent upon where the sun is in the day. But this goes back to that aspect question you're asking. So at least here, this aspect or this slope is much, much warmer in comparison to this slope. So this is a convex crater that kind of looks like this. The sun is hitting this one slope here off to the left and making it very, very warm. So this is now a new capability that we have that we can hopefully understand further the thermal properties that these cinder cones have. This can also be used in permafrost studies, and it's just really neat. And I saw this cool thing when I was kind of panning around. You know what this is? It's tracks. It's tracks, and you can see it in temperature. Isn't that wild?
That's awesome.
You can see the tracks. If you look very closely, tracks. So just by walking, you're changing the thermal properties of the cinders. And this is probably because we're either crunching them up or moving the cinders aside so that the ash layer is a little bit closer to the surface and heats up more. So just by walking around, you're changing the thermal properties of the summit, which I think speaks volumes to staying on the trails. That's just wild that you can see someone's trails in temperature. And then this is another thing that kind of applies to this project, but is also a little bit applied to a different project, the erosion project that was initially funding me. So this is just a raster image showing erosion. I go back and forth here. So this is deposition here. These are deposition lines. Then maybe this isn't the best color for the screen, but this is erosion here. And you can see it here. So this is calculated by using different point data sets that are separated in time. And you can see the deposition here is active management, currently being done by Ohm Cam, which is putting rocks, piles of rocks in where these erosion ditches and gulches are being created to help mitigate that erosion. So this is just some more cool information that's coming out about the summit that we're learning more and more about the environment up there. Here's another one showing the same thing. This is another erosion feature that you can see up there that's being actively managed. So I think these two things didn't necessarily apply to the Vakey Bug per se, but it's just a more holistic understanding of the summit in general, which is something that we're all trying to attain. It's a more holistic understanding. And with that, I'll leave you my favorite picture of a Vakey Bug. I passed around that little vial. So this is what they look like when they're alive. They're tiny, and I like this because not only does it show the Vakey Bug, it also shows its environment. These very irregular cinders with vesicles in them that sometimes they're all sorts of different colors, but on cinder cones. I think it just really nicely sums up the environment. And that's all I got. Thank you. All right.
Sorry about that.
Yeah,
any questions for Nathan?
So outside of the occasional seafood restaurant that they find there, what do these bugs sustain themselves on up there?
So they sustain themselves on dead and dying other arthropod species that have been blown up there. That's what I was talking about in the beginning. It's an aioli food source. So these bugs that are living at lower elevations get caught in wind columns that blow them to the top, kind of rain down, and then they die because they're not used to the environment up there. So these scavengers find these dead bugs and then they go inside.
So do you do anything with figuring out where the dead bugs fell and provided better food source? Yeah, different years, different months. I've read that they will vary wildly from year to year, and that might explain why the wake cube populations go up and down so much.
So that's a very interesting question. And a graduate, I can't remember her name. Leanne Eaton. She did a study on that, but instead of measuring bug fall, she measured snowfall and predicted that regions that kind of compile snow more so than others might also compile more dead bugs than others. So that's something that she looked at. And I briefly looked over her data and didn't see like a huge correlation between where we're catching the most bugs and where snowfall is the most. But then again, that's also a proxy for bug fall. Snowfall and bug fall is a proxy. Jesse and a number of other people do put these big pan bug traps up there to see how many bugs fall into these big pans. But again, this is very localized, very small section that you're measuring. So I think to answer your question is that hasn't really been done to the scale of the summit yet. But I'm sure that's definitely something that's driving where retention of the food source. Mm-hmm. Going off that too, we also don't know exactly how far they travel. So if they have a food source that's, you know, 10 meters or 100 meters or 1,000 meters away, if they make that distance, or what the distance that they travel is yet.
It depends how hungry they are.
Yeah, exactly. So
yeah. Well, that's a real concern.
Yeah.
If he's hungry, then environmental triggers to move towards it or not, mm-hmm. or they just go into hibernation. Mm-hmm. So it would really depend. The other thing is most of your data was summer capture data,
yeah.
not winter deposition
mm-hmm.
data for different years. So it's tough to figure out what goes on. That's what a lot of Jessica's working mm-hmm. on to see if there's seasonal variability where the bugs are.
Yeah, so Jess is, she's doing data capturing for every 3 months, I believe, whereas OMCAM does theirs just in the summer. So she's looking at seasonal variability, and then hopefully we can figure out the models with this new data and see if they change at all seasonally.
No radio callers for those guys yet for movement?
Well, we had some pink dye discussions tossing them in pink dye.
The most recent size of sensors that are being used for tracking honeybee movement is the size of that bug, which is still very small. I mean, that's like 3 millimeters.
Yes.
Yeah.
And they can use that to track honeybee movement.
Yeah.
At that point, but it's still way too big for a big bug. They still carry out its normal life.
So one question, looking at this and having done some of the data collection and that, it seems like the sample points are somewhat skewed by aspect. They're not entirely evenly distributed on some cones. Do you know how MaxEd accommodates that, like on, hypothetically speaking, if we're only really sampling on Haukea on the south and east aspects, mm-hmm. how does it know that the west and the north aspects are not good or not good
sure.
habitat?
Well, so there's two different ways that we've kind of dealt with that. I guess one way that we dealt with it, but the final models did say that slope wasn't really important at all. It had a very minimal impact on the overall habitat suitability. So you could venture to say that even if you're only sampling on one slope, it wouldn't make that big of a difference. Hopefully, it's also saying that, yeah, slope and aspect didn't really account for the biggest, it's called gains in the model. But, you know, we did a bias correction, which doesn't really help you if you're not sampling on a entirely different aspect, I suppose. But that's also something that hopefully Jess's work will answer. She's doing not only seasonal sampling, but also placing traps on every single aspect.
So another way that the model, maybe you can correct me if I'm wrong, but when MaxEd runs, does it not exclude smaller aspects of your data set so that you'll rerun the data multiple times? Does it do like multiple?
Yeah, it does something like 5,000 iterations.
Right. So sometimes it'll rerun itself and then compile the statistic by sometimes canceling perhaps 50% of your southerly locations because
mm-hmm.
it's randomly excluding data, which builds the model more generally, even if we had a much more biased sample on the south slopes versus the east slope.
Yeah.
It still would occasionally oversample what we did sample on the east slope compared to the south. So that which creates that robust model, even if you don't have
okay. So MaxEd tries to.
Yeah. So it's a correction.
Yeah, as much as it can, right?
Yeah.
So again, it's, you know, what's the data going in? So even before we get to that stage, this bias correction, right?
Yes.
We threw out some of the data already because we were trying to have a random sample.
Yep.
But the model is obviously very limited by what is the input data that goes in. And if there was more prep data, which just working really hard on getting, that should include the model.
Yeah.
So were there certain combinations of factors of minerals, temperatures, or whatever that might indicate better areas of finding bugs?
Definitely. So both of the models, the 1 meter and the 10 meter models, both kind of said that elevation and hematite were the biggest predictors of where we find them. So higher elevation cimacones that had hematite on them were considered the most suitable.
And hematite is the red.
Yeah, hematite is very red. It has iron in it, so it's very red. It's also very, very light. This is, I think, classic volcanic. It's very light, and the way that they stack together, there's a lot of space in between them.
And hematite was the most abundant cinder cone.
Yeah, if, I could probably try to find it.
Is it okay if I hit escape?
Do whatever you need to.
The other aspect of that is the spiders are up there, like maybe bugs. Maybe the only thing it is about hematite is they can hide from spiders. It doesn't necessarily mean that this model has anything to do with thermal input. It probably does, but we can't account for spider predation as eating all the lazy bugs that might be in the glacial tiller. So it's a neat tool.
Yeah, it can very well be a function of competition as well. So that's something that modeling different species can help to see if there's a lot of overlap or if there's not a lot of overlap between the different species that we have there. Because the spiders, the Lycosa spiders, and the caterpillars both eat the bugs, especially if they're in the same trap. They sometimes find just little layers, or they had, eaten the leaky bugs. So that's definitely a complexity in the study is competition. That's very hard to measure. And this is also just showing up those minerals. So here, these are cinder cones. They're almost wholly made of mostly hematite. Okay, it's a little interesting that it's hematite and classic volcanic rock. There's some others mixed in with some of the cinder complex here, but it's mostly hematite with some cinder.
So if some cinders have been disturbed by construction or people walking or whatever, do the Wakeheel bugs not like them as well?
So we haven't really captured a whole lot of Wakeheel bugs on the road. We also don't put a trap in the middle of the road. But yeah, the road doesn't really represent, if I go back to our final models too, I think this will highlight it quite well. So this one to the left, climate you can exclude, but this is our final model here. The road, you can kind of see it a little bit, but I guess I would say no. From the information that we have, it doesn't seem to negatively affect the number of captures on a given cinder cone. For example, if you take a cinder cone that's really been disturbed heavily or a cinder cone that has never been disturbed, we don't necessarily catch more on one cinder cone. In fact, I think Kea is the one that has the text. That's the best trap locale. We actually catch the most on that cinder cone, which has the two largest catalysts on the top. It's one of the highest in terms of area for disturbance, and we also catch the most bugs there, but I don't think that's necessarily a correlation between disturbance and amount.
Where did you find your first big bug you saw?
The very first one I ever found was in the CAC parking lot while I was eating lunch.
Where's the last one that you just found?
Oh, the last one. Interestingly enough, some observatory guys called us and they said, hey, we have this big electrical box that kind of looks like this, and the last time they opened it, it was full of bugs. Piles of bugs. I'm like, okay, let's check that out. So we opened it up. They're mostly Nisus palor, which is in the same family. But we did find a baking bug. It was inside an electrical box. It must have crawled in like a little crack somewhere. And there's hundreds of other bugs too, just piles of Nisus palor, which are they're related, but they fly. So that was interesting. Maybe they went in there to keep warm. This was just after a heavy snowfall period. So maybe that, or maybe they're attracted to the pulses or something.
But when you're modeling disturbance, it also matters the amount of disturbance that you could model and actually identify the models. So smaller areas that are roads that are disturbed might not affect the overall model, but running on a small point scale, not the same kind of rock anymore.
Yeah, there's also a lot of information in people that are studying disturbance levels. It seems like that there's a threshold that there can be this disturbance and you don't really see a whole lot of impact on the population. But then once you reach this disturbance threshold, then you can see a dramatic increase in the population. Usually downwards.
Increase?
Usually downwards. For example, like a forest, if you keep logging in forest, maybe you won't see a whole lot of population decrease, but then once you hit that certain threshold, you can see that may or may not apply.
It depends on the attack set.
Yeah, it's very different for bugs.
Fountain grass, sure, disturb it. That's what you want to prove.
Yeah.
But you know what, not.
It's a challenging environment because there's a whole lot of things and a whole lot of complexities going on.